Thank you so much, our choir. Give them another round of applause. I would just like to properly welcome our online audience and just to reiterate what this night is about. It's an inaugural Govan Mbeki Memorial Lecture by Mcebisi Jonas, and we're going to have a respondent, and he will be also introduced. The theme of tonight is Navigating Global and Domestic Turmoil, the Urgent Need for Visionary Collaborative Leadership. Now, honored guests, I would like to invite to the podium our Professor Sibongile Mutwa, our Vice Chancellor, to come forward, please, to welcome you all.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mueng. Dr. Mueng, as she has mentioned, she is our Executive Dean of the Faculty of Education. We've got 7 faculties, so she is one of our Executive Deans. Thank you very much for academic citizenship this evening. I want to greet our keynote speaker this evening, Mr. Mcebisi Jonas. When we worked together in the past, I used to call him Honorable Jonas, because that is what we're supposed to call them. I seem to have been able to move along, to move on. Thank you very much, Putimte. I want to greet my colleague, my friend, Professor Soma Dotafigeni, who is our respondent for this evening, but he's also a professor here at our university, Commissioner Figeni. I want to greet Mr. Mieletsi Mbeki and the members of the Mbeki family. I want to greet the members of our university governing council. I understand that the governing council is represented here on the venue by Councillor Michelle Mbato, who is our vice chair of council, and then our chair of council, Ambassador Nosipho January Badil, is participating online. I want to recognize our Chancellor, Dr. Geraldine Fraser Muleketi, who is also, I believe, is participating online, the members of the SRC of Nelson Mandela University, and all student leaders and political formations, including student societies. I want to greet the Nelson Mandela University staff, students, management, the deans, and our the DVCs, as well as other institutions, our sister institutions that are participating here in the Eastern Cape. The 4 universities here in the Eastern Cape try to work as a system of collaboration. And I understand that our partners from the Africa continent have also been involved and included in this evening's lecture. I want to greet the leadership of political parties that are here this evening. Particularly, I would like to single out the African National Congress and its veterans. And I'm doing this because this is the political home of the men that we are honoring tonight, Uom Gov Mbeki. I want to greet all the community members from across our province, and particularly here in our city where we are anchored, Nelson List. I was telling Putimte that I've got a long list of names, but I'm going to just mention them by categories instead of names. I've mentioned the Nelson Mandela University community, all of them, management to everyone that is part of the university. The provincial government of the Eastern Cape is represented here tonight. The Nelson Mandela Bay Metro Council members are here this evening, 2, 4, 6, 7 of them. The names have been given. I've already mentioned the African National Congress. I've been asked to recognize the African National Congress Youth League. I see some names of our former students on that list as well. And then the Eastern Cape Griqua Nation, their leadership are here, as well as four chiefs that are representing the Khoi. All of them, I understand, they are led by Chief Steenkamp, who participates a lot in our events. And then the various business leaders from the Nelson Mandela Bay Metro, they are listed. I'm not going to mention them by name. I want to recognize the friends of our family, of our university in all other categories. I saw my former colleague, Advocate Vusi Pikoli, and his wife, Kelly Pikoli, that I worked with, Advocate Pikoli, many, many years ago. I want to recognize Matsepo, Jonas, the wife of Putim ABC Jonas as well. We are welcome, ma'am. And all of you, all protocol is observed. I'm delighted to welcome you all to the first Govan Mbeki public lecture here at Nelson Mandela University. A warm word of welcome for those of you who are joining us in person and those who are joining us online, especially those partners and friends of our university that are participating from the continent and internationally. After extensive consultation and engagement with the Nelson Mandela Bay Metropolitan Municipality, who initially hosted this annual Govan Mbeki public lecture some time back, and with the approval and support of the Mbeki family, I am proud to announce that the Nelson Mandela University will champion the annual Govan Mbeki lecture in the forthcoming years. This year marks the fifth anniversary of our university adopting a new name, Nelson Mandela University. For us, this was not only a name change and corporate rebranding of our university. We changed our name in July 2017 to Nelson Mandela University to take on the name of Nelson Mandela. This was an opportunity for us to reorient our university, to give it a scholarly expression to the meaning and legacy of our iconic namesake, Madiba. With the name change also came an obligation for us to reflect Nelson Mandela's values and principles. It was a chance to rethink the purpose of a public university in society, indeed an opportunity to fundamentally rethink the meaning and purpose of higher education. The path we collectively chose is to be an embedded university in the service of society, promoting a socially just and sustainable world in carrying out our core mandates, which is learning and teaching, research and innovation, as well as engagement. For us, this practically means, among other things, having ongoing engagements with a wide range of internal and external stakeholders, stimulating intergenerational conversations focused on navigating societal issues and on promoting social solidarity in a context of weakening social fiber in many sectors of our society. The Govan Mbeki lecture, which seeks to memorialize and honor Dr. Govan Archibald Mvuyelwa Mbeki's life, ideas, and teaching, provides us with such opportunity of engagement. I am especially proud, as I've said, that from now on, we will host this lecture annually as the university. This is not only because UMGov stands as a towering historical figure in our country's history in his own right, but also because it reinforces the point that Nelson Mandela himself made, that he did not work in isolation as a leader, but was part of a broader collective. Thus, Nelson Mandela University is happy to be associated with some of his closest brethren and comrades. This annual lecture joins the entities of ours, like the Raymond Mhlaba Center for Governance and Leadership and the Govan Mbeki Maths and Science Development Center, which is doing sterling work in promoting maths and science education in marginalized communities, in giving recognition to the importance of collective leadership. Nearly 30 years into our democracy, South Africa is considered the most unequal society in the world and continues to grapple with high levels of poverty, inequality, and unemployment. Many of our young, predominantly black South Africans lack equal access to basic and higher education. In some remote parts of our country, residents still lack access to quality basic services. So it is not yet Uhuru. Women continue to be subjected to unacceptably high levels of gender-based violence and femicide, and more recently we've seen a growing trend of targeted at people from other African countries, as well as members of the LGBTQIA plus community. Crime levels in our country continue to rise, and we're still grappling with realities of landlessness, joblessness, and hopelessness. These harsh realities seem to suggest that many people remain marginalized and underserved. The theme of the 2022 inaugural Govan Mbeki public lecture, namely navigating global and domestic turmoil, the urgent need for visionary and collaborative leadership, is therefore very fitting. Thank you, Mr. Jonas, for that, because that was your idea. We are looking forward to what our keynote speaker and respondent will be sharing with us tonight around this theme, as we reflect on the character, life, and leadership of Uwam Gov and revisit his ideas and teachings. We would do well to consider the kind of leadership that we have and that we require to transform our society for the better. We are forced to be critical and honest in our reflections about the current state of affairs in our country, something Uwam Gov would have demanded of us, both as individuals and as part of a broader collective committed to bringing about change in our country. After all, not only was Uwam Gov a quintessential intellectual activist skilled in writing, teaching, journalism, politics, and history, he was a servant leader who always acted with integrity, a value he never compromised on. By his own words, he wanted to be remembered as a teacher. There are countless times when Uwam Gov demonstrated selflessness when co-leading in the struggle for liberation, whether it was when his work as a political organizer in the former Transkei resulted in 2 dismissals from his teaching posts, crippling him financially, or when his teaching days in a formal classroom was abruptly stopped in 1955, when the apartheid government banned him from any teaching activities, or when he served 23 years and 4 months on Robben Island following the Rivonia trial of 1963 and 1964, which I do not need to mention because I'm sure everyone is very much aware of that history of our country. Uwam Gov was an ultimate embodiment of discipline, and he understood the value of patience and perseverance in the struggle. He was not concerned with becoming a career politician or with instant gratification. He was concerned with the general well-being of the masses of his people. He understood the power of people when directed to building a fairer, more inclusive and just society, a society that is more responsive to the everyday needs of the people on the ground, a more responsible society, a more transformative and a more caring society. So as we gather today, Program Director, I'm now moving to sit down. I invite you to engage with the insights that our speaker will share against the backdrop rooted in the principles and teachings of Tata uGovan Mbeki. As I conclude, Program Director, I would like to express my gratitude again to our keynote speaker, Mr. Jonas, who is not a stranger to our university. He was recently here a few years ago to launch his book. And I want also to thank Professor Somato Dafikeni, who has agreed to be our respondent to share their wisdom with us and stimulate the discussion this evening. I also want to thank Mr. Mielezi Mbeki. After long conversations and phone calls to Alan and myself, for working with us in making sure that we host this inaugural lecture tonight. By extension, Puti, I also thank your family for giving us this honor. I would like to extend my particular appreciation to my colleagues, the director of CANRAD, Mr. Alan Zinn, and the chair of Critical Studies in Higher Education Transformation, led by Professor Kiet, and their staff, for all the work that has gone into putting together this Govan Mbeki lecture this evening. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Thank you so much, VC, for those warm words of welcome. Indeed, it is an honor, and I think it is a blessing for our university to have had the agreement of the Mbeki family to honor him in this way, to honor his life, as the VC says, his ideas and his teaching, so that we can take attributes, characteristics, and his disposition. Without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, now I'm going to introduce our speaker of the evening. Mcebisi Jonas is the chairperson of MTN Group. He holds various other non-executive board positions, including Northam Platinum and Signia Group. He is a former deputy finance minister of the Government of South Africa, a position he held between 2014 and 2017. Prior to his appointment to national government, Mcebisi played key leadership roles in the Eastern Cape, where he served as a provincial MEC of finance, as well as MEC of economic development, environmental affairs, and tourism. Mcebisi is currently one of the four independent presidential investment envoys appointed by the president, Cyril Ramaphosa, to promote foreign investment in South Africa. Honored guests, Mcebisi Jonas.
The program director, the vice chancellor, the leadership of the university, the members of the council, the members of the Mbeki family, in particular, Comrade Mweletsi Mbeki, who is increasingly becoming a useful sparring partner intellectually. and ladies and gentlemen, I would write on the protocol of the VC. Let me begin by thanking the Mbeki family and the leadership of the university for inviting me to give this prestigious lecture. The timing of this lecture is spot on as the world enters a new era of volatile geopolitics. The continent struggles with food poverty and climate disasters. And here in South Africa, the African National Congress prepares for its 55th National Electoral Conference. Everywhere around the world, citizens' satisfaction surveys show the worst results in the past 50 years. Most people around the world think the past was better than the present and fear the future, which is even becoming bleaker. Inequality and unemployment are increasing, inflation is rising, household and country indebtedness is also growing. The social fractures and polarization are on the rise in both developed and developing countries alike. Personalistic dictators who exploit the fears of citizens are on a quest for power everywhere you go. Everywhere, including in South Africa, here in South Africa, people seem prepared to give up democratic rights for vague promises of socioeconomic benefits. We are witnessing a rapidly escalating levels of geopolitical polarization. And Europe, our major trading partner, is in dire crisis. In South Africa, load shedding, unemployment, and food insecurity have hit the record high levels. The promise of the better life for all remains an illusion. Individually and collectively, we are emotionally exhausted, disillusioned about the state of our country and probably the state of the world, but also anxious about the future. We are in a survivalist mode and are turning on each other and lost our sense of nationhood. So how do we begin rebuilding our damaged national psyche? How do we respond and adapt to this unsteady and unpredictable landscape? How do we build new forms of socio-economic and socio-political, economic, and environmental resilience? How do we safeguard ourselves against the new forms of economic and political populism that thrive on chaos and uncertainty? More importantly, do we have the leadership to get us through the current moment? And what would a visionary and iconic leader like Govan Mbeki be doing in times like this? In trying to answer these questions, let me upfront disclaim that I'm no expert. Standing here on this university platform, speaking to you as academics, students, and experts and intellectuals, I feel strongly that I feel so small. I will structure this lecture in three parts. The first looks at the current moment, the key global and domestic trends that present, the nature of the crisis, as it were. The second part of the lecture looks at the political crisis and the underlying political philosophies thereof. I will argue that the real crisis is in the realm of politics. The third and final part of the lecture will look at the possible galvanizing agenda, and I will provide some thoughts on the kind of agency and leadership required to get us out of where we are. But first, let me make some comments about Mgov and how his personal, political, and intellectual traits might help us navigate the present. I suggest I will probably focus on three features that stand out. First, Mgov was scientific and analytical. He didn't take things at face value. He would want strategy to be well considered and based on rigorous analysis. This is not the case today. And I think Govan Mbeki would be appalled at the death of intellectualism and thought leadership in the ANC and broader alliance, as well as the rest of society. I know we currently put a lot of scrutiny on the ANC as the governing party, but if truth be told, there is not much fresh thinking outside of the ANC either. And this is not just a peculiar feature of South Africa. Since the 1990s, there have been very few big ideas, new ideas coming from communists, the left, socialists, or liberals, liberal intellectuals in the world over. And again, we can get into the debate, but I think in my view that this has been probably a product of the collapse of actually existing socialism, which actually led to left defeatism. And of course, the triumphant feeling of neoliberals that they run the world and the eventuality of their ideology. What Fukuyama calls the end of history. The second thing I'll say about Mgov was that he was historically specific, and his strategy was born out of an appreciation of the material conditions of the time. He was ideologically consistent, but not dogmatic. He was a Marxist and a communist, but of a kind informed by dialectical materialism. I'm quite sure he would have rejected the ahistorical autocratic leaning that occupies the populist left. I still find it hard to understand why some of our comrades, including those who partook in our hard-won democratic struggle, still embrace a personalistic autocrat like Vladimir Putin? Is it ignorance? Is it some kind of twisted Cold War nostalgia? My enemy is my friend? Or is it something worse and scarier? Aspirations for unrestrained power. The third, Gov had a real appreciation of political agency. Under apartheid, this was the Revolutionary Alliance, and he knew how, at different times in the revolution, depending on the circumstances that presented, different elements needed to front end the struggle, sometimes in combination with others. Over different periods, this included Mkhonto weSizwe, the international community, youth, trade unions, the broader mass democratic movement under the United Front, etc. I'm sure Gov would be asking hard questions today about the relevant agency to take our struggle forward and class alliances and compromises needed to achieve this. He would be very disappointed with the current leadership of the alliance. Mostly he would, I think, be disappointed by the lack of fresh thinking on these matters. It is interesting that two of his sons, Thabo and Mweletsi, are at the forefront of questioning and leading debates, albeit in different ways, on the issues of revolutionary agencies, of agency and class formation. I'm sure that Gov would have lamented the fact that 28 years into democracy, we have not succeeded in building a black productive class. As I argue in this lecture, this failure opens up to populist incursion. Fourthly, Gov, like many of other great leaders of his generation, was highly ethical with unquestionable integrity. He personified the notion of selfless struggle. As with other struggle icons, Mandela, Tambo, and others, we take consolation in the fact that he was spared the pain of witnessing the moral decline of the movement he dedicated his life to. So using these personal, political, and intellectual traits, how might one look at the current moment? It is useful to understand that our current problems are symptoms of a deeper set of interrelated questions and crises of the economy, of the environment, and of politics. Let me start with the economic crisis. I would argue that our current economic crisis is best understood as a growth crisis to begin with, as an inequality crisis, as an environmental crisis. We cannot address one component without addressing the other. I will start with the growth aspect of the crisis. Global shocks associated with the war in Ukraine, high inflation in Europe and the US, the political spiral in the UK, and slow recovery in China have caused global growth forecast to be downwardly revised. While recovery was upward of 6% in 2021, it is forecast at 3.2% for 2022, and just 2.9% for 2023. As recent as last week, UNTAD, United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, downwardly revised these to 2.5 for 2022 to 2.2 for 2023. Of course, the difference now is that in 2008, when we experienced the crisis, most government had liquidity. They had cash. They had fiscal space. Today, after COVID, most governments do not have the fiscal space to drive counter-cyclical measures. Developing countries are particularly at risk, particularly in the continent. South Africa's dilemma is that its growth prospects are today tied to global commodities demand and prices. South Africa is a small, open economy that has struggled to overcome its path dependency as a commodity exporter. We have not transformed our industrial structure. This has made us extremely vulnerable to global commodity cycle. Fixed investment levels in South Africa are very low. The National Development Plan sets a fixed capital investment target of 30%, and we are sitting currently at 14%. The prospects of a state-led investment to drive recovery are not good at all. With a highly constrained fiscus and more than 400 billion in bond redemptions due by 2026, high interest rates in developing countries, together with perceived business risk in South Africa, mostly linked to our electricity supply and corruption, is likely to see reduced foreign direct investment flows into the country in the short term. Of course, domestic investment doesn't look good either. This weak investment climate underlies our poor growth prospects, with projections for outer 3 years estimated at an average of 1.8%, lower than the 2.1% expected growth in 2022. South Africa is experiencing its longest downward phase since the World War II. This stagnant growth is accompanied by high inflation, what many people call stagflation, resulting in declining living standards for most South Africans. The working class is feeling the pinch. It's not surprising that the ANC leadership received frosty reception at the COSATU Congress recently. Unemployment is extremely high, of 34% on the narrow definition, and is likely to increase to around 40% by 2030, unless something drastic happens. The so-called Operation Vulindlela was intended to fast-track structural reforms to trigger growth. I think it was a step in the right direction, but it is severely hamstrung by state weaknesses in execution. Partly this is related to the dynamics in the governing party that is almost completely preoccupied with positions at the upcoming conference. I don't know whether presidents are six presidents contesting. With no discernible focus on the big issues. Outside a handful of people in the National Treasury, possibly the presidency, and two other departments, I'm concerned that our current leadership do not have the full appreciation of the scale and depth of the current crisis. Hence the lack of urgency, fresh ideas, and focus on getting things done. Beside our growth dilemma, we also have an inequality dilemma. Obviously, these are linked. Our high inequality constrains growth, and our low growth limits the prospects for redistribution, especially fiscal redistribution. South Africa has a Gini coefficient of 0.63, and was recently named, as Professor Sbongile said, by the World Bank, as the most unequal of the 164 countries that were benchmarked. The black share of income in South Africa has increased with the growing black middle class, but the black share of wealth has not changed significantly. I dare say it's almost closer to apartheid days, if not. This has to do with South Africa's high levels of market concentrations and barriers to entries, which constrain economic participation. In recognition of this cappuccino economy, black at the bottom, white on top, and in response to ongoing capital denationalization, government intensified efforts to create a so-called patriotic capitalist class through a developmental state. Of course, many people will question the possibility of a patriotic capitalist. This led to prioritization of a number of positive discrimination policies, affirmative action, BEE, preferential procurement, set-asides, etc. But all these measures have increasingly been compromised by state incapacity and corruption. The state has been placed at the center of black wealth creation. But the model has been vulgarized through classic processes of clientelism, should I add, primitive accumulation, which rents became tied to political patronage and invariably undermines institutions and state capacity. The result resulted in hollowing out of critical capabilities in the criminal justice system and security cluster. This in turn enabled the broader criminalization of various aspects of South African life and makes the country especially vulnerable to international crime syndicates. In fact, South Africa is increasingly becoming a big crime scene. This is well described in last month's report by the Global Initiative Against Transnational Organized Crime, which highlights the rapid rise of new organized crimes such as extortion and kidnapping. We have become a growing market, not for dollar flush tourists, as we had hoped, but international criminals. This would get us grey-listed by the Financial Action Task Force, which will, amongst other things, make it far more difficult to attract capital into the country. Our weakened criminal intelligence capabilities were terribly exposed, if you recall, during the armed unrest in July 2021. Fiscal constraints and diminished resources feeding patronage networks have intensified conflict within the ANC. Democratic cornerstones such as the Constitution, the rule of law, human rights remain vulnerable until such time that we have transformed our economic model. And that's fundamental. There is a fundamental link between the economic model that we're driving and the extent to which our democracy is vulnerable. Part of the step change required is building of a new productive elite that creates wealth through innovation and entrepreneurship. This probably aligns very well with Mweletsi's thinking that the ANC power base is primarily a consumptive elite that has little interest in developing productive capacity or sustaining institutions for that matter to achieve this. The third dimension of economic crisis is climate change and the energy crisis. Our energy crisis dominates our everyday life and negatively affects us. Whether you are a woman walking home through darkened streets or a small business losing vital turnover, each day we load shed, it costs the economy between 500 million and 700 million per stage. So stage six, where we are, short of 6,000 megawatts, which we need to shed, the cost to the economy is between 3 billion and 4.2 billion per day. How did we get there? I suppose the simple answer is poor planning and indecision. In 1994, only 36% of South Africa's 40 million population had access to electricity. In other words, our generating capacity and grid served less than 15 million people. Of course, you understand, apartheid planners were clear. Black South Africans were not meant to have electricity. Today, 85% of South Africa's 60 million people have access to electricity. That is, I'm assuming, when there's no load shedding. But we have not added done very little to add to our generating capacity. So we still have the same generating capacity with all that growth. And that creates the current 6,000 megawatt shortfall. This has also meant that Eskom's overstretched coal-fired power stations have had to run on full capacity with little to no time to attend to maintenance. A problem made worse by skill drains and corruption. We currently need at least 20,000 megawatts of new generating capacity over the next 10 years. And this is probably an incredibly tall order for any country for that matter, but especially one like ours with very poor track record of managing large projects. Underlying this structural energy crisis has been a policy uncertainty. Initially, in the 1980s and 1990s, and 1990s, the plan was to privatize generation capacity. We saw the state withdraw capital investment, and I want to add that it seems long-range planning responsibility as well, because Eskom used to have long-range planning capability. This decision was later revised, but with only Kusile and Medupi planned and implemented, albeit poorly, as new generating facilities. The past decade has seen much policy flick-flacking between renewables, coal, and nuclear, of course aggravated by corruption, which slowed down implementation of private sector-led renewable programs, and of course, poor leadership. Fortunately, we now seem to be on the right track with a commitment to more competitive energy market, the massive private sector and DFI-driven renewable program, as well as unbundling of Eskom into generation, transmission, and distribution facilities. We must also admit, though, there are still big issues to address, which will require decisive and unwavering leadership. These include immediate attention to the 6,000 megawatt generation shortfall, establishing a base load, dealing with Eskom's 400 billion debt, and leveraging the $8.5 billion concessional financing, and of course, more importantly, compensating the losers of the energy transition, particularly coal mining communities, who will become very important and vulnerable. The war in Ukraine has highlighted energy poverty on the continent, with way too little concessional financing being directed to Africa's way in order to boost the transition. It is highly likely that the African continent will fail to meet their net zero targets, which will affect access to global investment. And I want to argue that South Africa has a huge role to play in this regard as the thought leader on transition. I will now turn to the political crisis. It is useful to briefly go back to the democratic transition and relook at the consideration that gave rise to the political settlement in 1994. As with the former Eastern Bloc countries, we had a form of elite-led democratization in which the ruling elite acceded to concessions, in our case, political rights with redistributional benefit. This typically only happened when the cost of concessions outweigh the cost of status quo. In our case, the cost of repression and economic sanctions and the risk of a violent revolution. And I think the couple of scholars outlining this, Robinson, Asameglu, and Donnell. Such top-down or elite-driven political transitions rarely produce variants of democracy in which there are political rights, property rights, and civil rights. Mukant and Roderick go to town on this point. In fact, democratic transitions that guarantee all three buckets of rights, political, property rights, and civil rights, are an exception rather than the rule in society with huge social cleavages and inequality like South Africa. As Robinson and Asameglu put it, most developing societies are unable to walk that narrow path where you have those three rights and yet you are unequal as a country. Liberal democratic variants of democracy usually occur where there is significant industrialization, as in the West, in Western Europe and the US, and where there are relatively homogeneous populations with minimal social cleavages, Korea or Japan, as an example. South Africa is an exception, and I want to argue that this is probably not something we appreciate enough as analysts and those who are activists. As part of the 1994 deal, the property elite were given protection against expropriation risk in exchange for political rights. But the deal was exceptional in that it provided for civil rights as part of the exchange, most likely because the property elites overlapped with the minority elite in whose favor the civil rights part of the exchange would have worked. But why did the ANC accede to this compromise? I think it's very important that we revisit that historical moment to see whether objective and subjective circumstances have changed, which could cause the governing party to reconsider the terms of the exchange. I suggest six reasons why the ANC chose the path. The first, the ANC was inherently a democratic and conscious of human rights. And we can see the evidence of this in the Freedom Charter, the Bill of Rights, etc., and many debates, those who follow history. Whilst this was the thinking of the ANC of the old, the ANC of Govan Mbeki, has it been passed down the generation? I'm not sure. The second was, the apartheid government still controlled the cohesive apparatuses of the state and would have unlikely exchanged political rights without acceding to both property and civil rights, which protected minority interests. Thirdly, the ANC appreciated the risk of capital and skills flight. If we did not accede to property and civil rights, even though in reality, of course, many skills left the country, a lot of capital left the country, but I think it helped to contain and maintain some level of skills and capital in the country. The fourth reason, we thought that there were sufficient provisions in the constitution of asset redistribution, be affirmative action, redistributive fiscal policy. Even as we now acknowledge poor transformation outcomes 28 years later, the debate continues whether this is because of state incapacity, the fact that we have poor outcomes in terms of transformation, or weak execution, or mismatched fiscal policy, or is it our gaps in our constitution? I'm clear in my mind that there are no gaps or shortcomings in our constitution, but rather one of state failure. This is a problem of state failure, basically, and poor execution. And I always marvel the debate about the land reform, because essentially the land crisis in South Africa is a political and execution failure. It has nothing to do with the constitution. Fifth, the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991 came at a time as South Africa's transitional exchange was being negotiated. Of course, there was a buzz in globally, stronger appetite for more peaceful resolution of conflicts and reduced opportunities for non-democratic paths of transition. Now, all of those factors combined, and lastly, I must say, for developing economies, South Africa had a fairly high levels of industrialization, which seems to be general preconditions for the variant of democracy that guarantees political rights and property rights and civil rights. And if you look at other developing countries, they have very weak industrial base. So what does this mean for us going forward? Because I was not just giving you a history lecture. Are we likely to sustain the 94 democratic exchange? Are we likely to backslide? In answering these questions, we need to be cognizant of the shifting sands globally, with the new politics of self-expression, of identity, and of polarization, which is fast replacing the old politics of compromise and consensus. This new politics is constructed around a narrative of victimhood. It is built around a damaged national psyche. You may think of Germany between the world wars or post-Cold War Russia. It is about citizens not just wanting to change government, but wanting to change the entire political system. Populist models characterized by leaders like Orban, Trump, Bolsonaro, or Putin have in common the identification of a common enemy, often along national or ethnic lines, and the exploitation of existing or perceived social cleavages to drum up support. Worryingly, populism is taking root amongst the young people. As Ivan Krastev points out, by way of example, if the over 65s did not vote in France, Macron would have lost the elections. So the analysis that Krastev gives is that actually he was carried by over 65s to win the elections. The idea of defeating common enemy trumps national policy, as is evident in Russia's invasion of Ukraine. How could this play out in South Africa? Do we have a Ukraine phenomenon? Probably foreigners might be the galvanizing thing. Minority groups, the property elite, what irrational decisions might we take? Could we follow Zim's disastrous land reform program? Could the ANC adopt a narrative of African victimhood to survive? Are some of these traits already on show? How often have we heard the narrative that democracy might not be appropriate for Africa? Or ironically echoing the old modernization paradigm that democracy might not be appropriate for the current stage of development. As I move to conclusion, I would want to propose four sets of actions that we need to galvanize around to both preserve our democracy gains and put ourselves on a path of shared prosperity. The first, we need economic growth. This is a non-negotiable and should trump all other outcomes in the short term. Without growth, living standards will continue to decline, unemployment will continue to rise, and social protections will continue to be eroded. In the immediate term, we must get on top of our energy crisis and rising crime levels and remove regulatory impediments for many sectors. Secondly, we need to do far more to address inequality. Democracy will always be under threat where there is no coincidence of interest between the elite and the rest of society. That's probably a very powerful message that has a lot of evidence and precedents elsewhere. If there is no coincidence of interest between elites and the rest of society, that system is unlikely to be sustainable. We need to be very deliberate in building black entrepreneurial startup that creates wealth through productivity and innovation to replace the rent-seeking elite. The private sector and banks have a critical role to play. They must come to the party to enable this through market sharing and co-creation. As Asamoah and Robinson remind us, democracy needs a productive elite that is vested in stability of institutions, as opposed to a consumptive elite. Thirdly, we need to rebuild the state. Francis Fukuyama argues that a strong state is needed for democracy to be sustained. Our slow progress in rebuilding the state capacity, particularly in the aftermath of state capture, is unforgivable and carries huge risk for the democratic project in South Africa. Statecraft should not become all our concern, as opposed to be the concern of government. The starting point must be institutions that build human capability, and that is education and health. I mean, if you think about state failure, I would argue that it's reflected in education outcomes, it is reflected in health outcomes, and of course, security. And all of those are so fundamental in rebuilding this economy. So the project of building the state, it's not about building a lot of advisory institutions and what have you. It is about a focus program to deal with the key areas of government, education and health, as well as the security aspect, public safety. Fourth, we need to rethink political agency. Our default position has always been the ANC. But the ANC of old and the current iteration of the ANC are quite different things. Po- Political parties are meant to have a restraining effect on leaders. And this is very important. I call it filtering effect on leadership. That the political party, because it's strong, what comes out as leadership becomes stronger because the political party is strong. So they have that role to play, and therefore they give us good leaders. China is an example where the party has actively prevented the rise of dangerous personalistic leaders. But this is not always the case, obviously, like with Trump and a host of other demagogues. Clearly, we cannot rely on the opposition parties to navigate the political crisis. Some of them trade on populist politics, whilst others are driven by narrow minority interest. Again, like the fight against state capture, we must mobilize a robust, vigilant civil society underpinned by strong intelligentsia. Because I think sometimes we undermine the importance of intelligentsia. We need strong ethical leaders, and we know we have many, to step up, take charge in all corners of all institutions. To be clear, politics is not about philosophical posturing or PR. It is about taking decision. It is about being practical and pragmatic. It is ultimately about action and change. And if your politics does not do that, then you have to think twice. In conclusion, Ivan Krastev reminds us how the dissolution of Soviet Union in 1991 caught everyone by surprise. We knew there were problems, many people knew there were problems, but the problems have become so normalized that the real extent of the structural crisis was hidden. I feel that is where we are as a country. We know there are problems, but these problems have become so normalized that actually we take them for granted. And there's a load shedding, these guys. The problem with understating the nature of structural crisis is that we will not be able to influence an explosive trajectory once it materializes, because one day it will materialize. The original concept and foregrounding of our nation is gone, defeated by paralysis, delivery paralysis, state capture, crime, load shedding, and lack of real economic transformation. All of this exacerbated by weak leadership. How do we rebuild a new unifying national identity? One that asserts the economic interests of African majority without going down the populist road of African majoritarianism, which could well lead to state capture 2.0 and the downward slide to a failed state. We clearly need new vision that can address both growth and transformation outcomes. Despite the platitudes about inclusive growth, we have not yet developed an economic model that delivers both growth and transformation. The ANC remains highly fractured and needs to be thoroughly reoriented at governing a modern state and a competitive economy. The constant ritualistic drumbeat about ANC's organizational renewal dumbs down the debate about political agency and is a far cry from what the country needs. The only logical conclusion one can derive from years of talk about the eye in the needle, those in the ANC know the document, is that the eye is too wide or the needle is too wobbly. The farcical coalition politics we are witnessing, and they are showing the evidence of political immaturity that exists in our political parties. The political theater might be entertaining, but it's taking us nowhere very fast. To move forward, we need to change the narrative of inevitability and act with unity of purpose to rebuild our society. The alarm bells of state failure are ringing, but we are not yet a failed state. And it is within our hands to change things. We are a nation of very capable and resilient people and institutions. We need to live by the words of the Welsh Marxist Raymond Williams, who said, to be truly radical is to make hope possible rather than despair. Our collective despair tends to foster paralysis. I, like you, am tired of being disillusioned, feeling helpless. The gloom and normalized state of crisis must be replaced by hope and practical action. We must reimagine our society, embodying values and spirit of our forefathers like Omkov, but based on new politics, because I think most political parties like history, because you have nothing to show today. You keep on harping on the history. Glorious, glorious movement. I believe the people of this country have the power to change our destiny. Let's get it done. I thank you.
Yes. Mr. Chairman. Thank you so much. So much food for thought, ladies and gentlemen. How did we get here? How do we rebuild one unifying identity as a nation? We need action so that we can change. Thank you so much, Mr. Mcebisi Jonas. Really, you've given us food for thought. And I could hear people, you know, squirming in some of the sections of your speech, agreeing, you know, with what you were saying, and some just wondering what it means, what you are saying. I want to acknowledge our online audience. There are no questions yet, and we're going to deal with questions later on. But thank you for the comments that you have shared with us, showing support for the lecture and saying that you are excited for this lecture this evening and the kind of insights that you are gaining from the lecture. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, I would like to now introduce our respondent, Professor Soma Dodafikeni. Soma Dodafikeni was born at Mount Elif, Emaxasibeni, and he hails from Lugelweni village in the Alfred Nzo district of the Eastern Cape. Oh, wow, yes. He acquired his BA and BA honors in politics and social sciences from the University of Transkei, which is currently known as Walter Sisulu University. He also studied peace and political studies program at McMaster University in Canada, obtained his Master of Arts in International Politics and Comparative Development at Queen's University, which is also in Canada. He went on to obtain his doctoral studies in comparative politics and public policy analysis at Michigan State University in the USA. His areas of expertise are policy analysis, comparative politics, research methodology, international politics, political economy, and heritage. He is an author, a researcher, public speaker, and commentator on a range of local and global political, social, and heritage, as well as economic issues. He is one of the most recognized figures among South African and African political and social commentators, widely used by local, national, continental, and global media. He has chaired various national, provincial, and local boards, councils, task teams and projects. From 2014, you can come along. From 2014 to December 2020, I cut it short. It's not as long as what you've given me, so it's okay. From 2014 to December 2020, he was a director of the Vice Chancellor's Special Projects and an advisor to the Vice Chancellor of the University of South Africa. in December 2020, was appointed Associate Professor to the new UNISA Thabo Mbeki School of Public and International Affairs. In 2021, was appointed as Visiting Professor of the Nelson Mandela University. As I conclude, he is currently the chairperson of the Public Service Commission of South Africa, also founding member and chair of the Indlulamithi South Africa Scenarios 2030 Board of Trustees. Also elected president of the Michigan State University Alumni Network in December 2021. Honored guests, Professor Somadida Fikeni.
Program Director, indeed, in any search for any future employment, I'll ask that they send this clip. They'll just play it and I won't even repeat and add to what you said. The Vice Chancellor, the Chancellor, the council members, the leadership of the university, the keynote speaker, the Mbeki family, and all various stakeholders and leaders here. Wow, what do you do to respond to such a compelling, extensive and intensive dissection of the situation today? I guess the best way is to say, I have nothing to say, but I'll take my time to say so. What is most interesting, as I was reflecting on the responses, is the kind of a person after whom this lecture is actually prepared, Govan Mbeki. He was a giant intellectual. He was a political activist. He was on the ground, but he was still fascinated by ideas. So to him, it was that meaningful dialogue between concepts, theories, ideas, and practice. And whatever he was reflecting, it's what he was also experiencing. When he writes about the peasant revolt, he would talk about the places he had visited, the people he had met. Unlike most of the scholars of today, they will write because there was an allowance to write or a sponsorship, because there was pressure, the Senate is sitting for promotion, which in essence is academic career pathing rather than being organic intellectual. To a great extent, the keynote speaker is also a political activist involved in the corporate world, but also curious about ideas, which means if you live long enough, Zikali, you'll also be Uom Jonas. There's Uom Ray, there's Uom Gov, and if you get your 80s, you have earned your stripes to be Uom Jonas. But on a serious note, there's never been a time in our history when the words of Walter Khubusana were so appropriate to say, Zemkinkomo Magwalandini, given the multiple crises that we're confronted with. But the biggest challenge, which I think you alluded to, as Amartya Sen was saying about India at one stage, applies to us. We're a noisy, argumentative, temperamental, headline-obsessed democracy. And very often we produce more heat than light. And the challenge with that, even if you travel around the world, you pick up a newspaper, read column articles. In other countries, you have a sustained focus on developmental issues. But in South Africa today, it could be load shedding. 3 days later, it's Mamboi and somebody sleeping with a goat. That becomes a topic. Then the following week, it will be something else. We hardly ever sustain any discourse. And because of this roving mind, we do not deserve any solution. Because we have not invested in any solution, nor do we have any attachment to long-term vision. Any Asian tiger, any China that is able to remove 700 million people in 15 years out of poverty, they stick to a particular plan, even when you have change of leadership. But in our case, what happens? People from the same ruling party, when they change, you'd think that somebody was removing a Gestapo from the office. And those were actually the words of one of the ministers not long ago, your own comrade. The next thing they'll want to change the curtains, the furniture, as if it has been bewitched. And those lifestyle issues become so dense that the mindset of thinking about the future and the legacy dissipates. So that is the first challenge in the collective psyche of this country. We have no focus. We're roving. What you see in the social media can define the mood of that day. The following day, it's something else. We are hot and cold. So that's the first challenge. But there's much focus, Babu Jonas, on the leadership and institutional capacity, which is the right thing. And we've debated this issue at the Indlula committee, where we said the key drivers is leadership, is the institutional capacity, inequality, and so forth. But I want to argue this evening that we've forgotten one thing. The people's agency. Because once you have people with a certain kind of attributes or consciousness, or even patriotic zeal, I mean not zeal, but rather patriotic disposition, it is that seedbed from which leadership is recruited. And that people's capacity, you can take it into even a microcosm of a family, the collapse of an African family, and all other primary socializing agents like your education, the media, the church, and so forth. All those institutions have collapsed. And yet these are the spaces which used to create a fertile ground for grooming of a leader with certain kinds of values. If they have collapsed, where do you groom this leadership? When an uncle now is a predator who can rape a niece instead of provide that guidance. The second or the third issue I want to raise, I raised it recently when I invited Father Smangaliso Mkhatshwa to the Public Service Commission and Professor Rousseau, who is the head of the Ethics Institute, said, can you explain to me, we want to promote these constitutional values, how do you explain the fact that everybody understands the Constitution, everybody understands some of these values cognitively, but they behave differently, which means they have not internalized them. Even the ruling party creates an O.R. Tambo school where they simply narrate histories of Morogoro, which you can understand from Google without going to a school. What kind of education must we have which has deep immersion and conscientizing feature, so that when you walk in and come out, you are different? I invited Professor Ngudlu again and I said, what must be done by business schools and schools of government such that people do not use the training in those to claim leadership and start stealing? Because most of the people who are now facilitators of theft, they want to be a DG or CEO, they say, I have an MBA. What did they miss in the processing plant that they come out intelligent, but dangerously intelligent? And this actually goes even to the stakeholders. Universities used to be places where we look forward to intellection. But what happens? I was invited to speak to the SRC's presidents and secretaries. And I said, if you look at the anatomy of student leadership, looks like it's also a grooming space for nice things in life. So if you graduate and refine your skills of saying, should I get a position, I'll sleep in a five-star hotel, I'll have an allowance, I'll fly, I'll be invited to this, and therefore I've arrived. It has nothing to do with saying, if I'm given the opportunity, I could change the world. It says, if I am given the opportunity, I could change my lifestyle. So what chances, therefore, I'm hoping that the sound engineer is not one of the student leaders. And this goes to the unions themselves, where you say, I want to appropriate the notion of representing you in order to represent myself. It goes to churches. Prayers have been captured. Unions have been captured. Political parties have been captured. Everybody captures any institution to get ahead. And the next point I want to raise, we are in social sciences what we call the VUCA moment, volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. In the past, leaders would face a crisis, but that crisis was cyclical. It would end. What capacities do leaders of today need to have to deal with permanency of what used to be transient, to be resilient? If you're dealing with doi doi VC, or you're dealing with contestations over this, or it's a permanent feature, it's not a passing phase. As others would say, no, the world war has passed, therefore we're going to rest. So the geopolitical volatility as well, the technological volatility as well, as Alvin Toffler said, that which used to be transient is going to be permanent in its state of instability. I won't speak to the appropriation of liberation, revolution, and so forth. I no longer pay much attention once people invoke and weaponize those words, because you know they mean the opposite very often. Once a person says, I'm a tried and tested comrade, I know what was happening in Morogoro, know that they are driving on a highway using a rear view mirror, not focusing on a windscreen. In time, they will crash. I really agree with the would-be warm Jonas on the issue of elite transition. In one paper I'm writing, I talk of the missing link. If you look at South African history, each time people have been given agency or they have demanded agency, they come up with something positive. Freedom Charter, people from different walks of life, they produce something. Mass democratic movement, people from different walks of life, sports, cultural groups, church groups, everybody felt we needed to do something. Black consciousness movement mobilized people and said, it is in your hands, the agency. But post-CODESA, people were politically demobilized in a very smart way to say, we leaders are going to take care of you. Historically, that has never happened. Leaders take care of themselves. And very often you thought they would transform the environment. They simply were bedazzled by the environment and get assimilated to it. Hence the point that Mbeki was saying, that we are competing to accumulate wealth using political institutions to compete with billionaires of old wealth in the corporate world. That's the rent-seeking and very, you know, crude extraction from people. But let me just quickly highlight the following and then sit down. The first one, what if we have a structural defect in the factory that produces leadership? By that I mean, if the political class has determined that they can't make it in business, They can't make it in the professional world. The only place with the lowest threshold is politics. Do you think they will allow any flicker of light of brilliance there when you want to crowd them out of that space? Now think of it. Today you were selling your fruit somewhere. Chances in life closed. Tomorrow you become a counselor. You are told you are going to go to a workshop in Germany. Things start opening up. And you do not have any profession or business acumen to back you up. And one day you are told you are going to be removed from the list. That's more like pronouncing a capital punishment to a person. They won't even understand what you are talking about. Because the lifestyle has dramatically changed. Now you are suggesting to them, go back with no plan. Some alienated themselves from their relatives. Now you are saying go back, and you expect that there will be no political killings. Let's just be serious. I would have spoken to professionalization of public service, and more so because that political drama in theater is not going to end soon. But what you can reform faster might just be the public service and professionalize it so that it can absorb the shocks of politics, of coalition, and politics of instability. Hence, in other countries, you see coalition governments collapse every day, but it's not a big deal because things are functioning. But if you have the failure of state capacity at the same time with the failure of politics, it's a dangerous concoction. I would have spoken to the post-COVID-19 psychosocial pandemic. We often fail to understand the woundedness and the fragility of our society. Whether victims of GBV or people who have lost their loved ones during COVID-19 and many other social ills, people who have several Nyaupe representatives in their family, who from that traumatized environment without ever talking about healing that space first. And what happens has not delivered. Because that day may come. Remember, it was the politics first, the executive got delegitimized. They were too much involved in state capture and a lot of the stealing. Public service, the Afro Barometer has indicated this delegitimization. It comes to churches, all the pastors now, not all, quite a number. You have one representative in this region too. They are actually discouraging agency of people. The moment you say, what are you entitled to? Without having in the same discourse, what should be your contribution? What are your limits? So we've become a rights society, no responsibility society, and that's not sustainable. And I should just conclude by saying, what is the right balance between legacy-related challenges and contemporary policy failure challenges? Because those who belong to or who have benefited from the legacy of colonialism and apartheid blame the current state on the current leadership. And the current leadership blame everything on the legacy. So we have such a disconnect and dishonest discourse where we are not saying, this one, it's because of Jan van Riebeek and Malan Fervut. This one is because of you guys who are now in charge. Some throw history, others throw contemporary. Even those who say forgive, they say forgive those who happened before 1994, but punish these ones. And these ones say, just punish those ones, and so forth. So it's a very disjointed discourse. Had there been time, I would have spoken to this new wave of writing, which is quite promising, where most of the books are saying what is to be done. Like the one you penned, like Abo Zibi, who talk of the manifesto. Before then, there was a wave which was fatalistic, saying, are we coming to an end? South Africa has begun its descent, and so forth. So that in itself, I think to me, is a very positive development. And ultimately, what are the conditions for social compact? What is that? Creating a space for national dialogue that builds consensus on the way forward, on the trade-offs. That ultimately is what I do think, not the kind of social compact that I think is being misunderstood, where sometimes they think people can microwave it in a few days into existence. I'm talking about the serious social compacts. Thank you very much.
Staging. Thank you so much, Professor Somate Dodafikeni. And education, we need education with deep immersion and conscientization. We need a social compact. Honored guests, we are now going to move to our questions, and I am aware of the time, and I understand that we have students who need to get to their public transport to take them to the residences. So when we open up the questioning session, please stick to the question. Do not contextualize your question and make your own public speech, but just, you know, be concise in your questioning. We have a question online. Usolom Zichona, who is the president of the University of Fort Hare Convention. And the question is to Wom Jonas. What is the best possible solution to the current electricity crisis? And then we have a caution from Prof. Janet Cherry, directed at the respondent, Professor Fikeni. And she says, we should be wary of trading civil rights for Chinese model of politics and development. And this is related to the first proposition. I'm going to take one round. I'm sure you've jotted down the questions. One round of questions. We've got roving mics. And I'm going to take three questions from the floor. Please raise your hand so that we can see. And I recognize this hand here. Up, is it? Up. And then there's number two there. And Bonnie Gengok Feder. Nalapa. All right. So there's three already. Okay. Over to you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Jonas, I'm just curious, right? And it seems to be sort of a trend among public state entities to sell, you know, companies to the private sector, right? Within telecommunications, given the, how can I say it, special nature of it, where, you know, it's given its rights through spectrum and its limitations, so on and so forth, right? and which has sort of created a situation where there are oligopolies in the space, and the price for accessing telecommunication services is quite high. What does it mean for the consumer when MTN purchases Telkom? How will it impact from an access point of view? And secondly, what will it do from an innovation point of view, given the fact that competition from time to time does encourage companies to innovate? Thank you very much.
Thank you. The second question over there.
Thank you. My question is going to Mbeki. Thank you for that detailed lecture. It was very informative. I appreciate that you did not go through history. You were just focusing on the current state. My question is, what is your take on the 9 wasted years? Because you did touch on the current state, that the fiscal deficit, the effects, and all the things that the economy that is undergoing currently. So what is your take on the 9 wasted years? Because on the media, what we are told, you don't really get in relation what was happening with the economy during those 9 wasted years. So ndiyacela manje khalinje ukhesi uSteve Vacha Vacha.
Thank you. And yes, next question.
Thank you very much. Kamala Mgustembele Tutuse. Now I'll be practical, and I want practical solutions. I'm an engineer by profession, so I don't like the hitting around the point. So what can we do to save our economy, and how can we break the barriers of participation? You know, it's difficult to enter into business. When you have a job, your employer doesn't allow you to go and participate in. What can we do? Should we, you know, maybe rise, but we don't want to do that because we don't want to hit the economy, but what can we do practically, especially in rural areas, to bring back jobs in those areas, to reduce immigration, yabantu, and to ensure that people participate in the economy? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for those questions. Over to you. Do you have a mic with you? Oh, thank you. All right.
Probably this. Can I start with the electricity one? I guess, I mean, the solution is there, I think. And it's probably sitting in a number of areas. The one part is almost reforming the energy sector in South Africa, fundamentally. And part of that entails separating generation from transmission and distribution. I mean, this is obviously something that is probably in the process at the moment. But more importantly, I think, is that in the short term, I think the problem is might not be the ideas about what to do, but the problem might be how to do it and the capacity to execute, which I think is part of a state building program, basically, that so everyone knows what needs to be done, but it's not happening. And it's not happening because I think in part the politics are terrible. In part, I think you have constraints in terms of execution. So part of what needs to happen in almost quickly is to bring the skills that ESCOM requires as quickly as possible. And my view is that if those skills are not in the country, I think open up and bring them from wherever you can bring. Because the fundamental problem of ESCOM is a generation problem. That's where the problem lies. And whether you're going to solve that, I think in part is building the capacity to generate more. The other part is opening up the electricity sector and allow for private sector to participate in the generation so that you have competing markets also, because it also affects the price. So that would be, and there are issues to do. But essentially, you've got to address the capacity issue. I don't think it's a matter of what to do. The other part of it is debt. Because my view is that Eskom debt is state debt, ultimately. So I think it's logical that government should absorb a portion of that debt and therefore improve the balance sheet of Eskom, and therefore Eskom can begin to make the appropriate investments, as it were. And we must also avoid this temptation to think that when we're faced with crisis, we're going to change CEOs and quickly, and so on and so on. The truth of the matter is that the problem is structural, the problem is political. So if you think that tomorrow you just change somebody and then the thing gets solved, you'll actually be surprised that you get into more problems, as it were. So that will be my take. I don't know whether somebody was talking about the Chinese model and what have you and what have you and what have you. But I guess, I mean, where I'm sitting is that in South Africa, we cannot escape the vital importance of ensuring that our democracy has all the three baskets, your property rights, your civil rights, etc. So it's important that we actually understand that even despite the levels of inequality, etc., we've got to ensure that we maintain that at all costs. So dealing with inequality is fundamentally important because it helps us actually navigate the path towards a more equitable society that we cannot escape. But I would actually kind of veer away from saying we're going the Chinese route, because I think in China, let's face it, I mean, in South Africa, you would never have that, if you might ask my opinion. But there's something to learn, obviously, in China. State capacity is one of them. Almost a focus on building the state and the capacity of the state. But there's something else to learn also around how you mobilize private sector towards a national developmental agenda, which is something that in South Africa we've been unable to do. In fact, we tiptoe around the private sector in that sense. Oh, there's a lot of mistrust. I mean, because the state itself cannot be trusted, and so it can't legitimately, with integrity, drive a conversation with the private sector. But I would kind of say, democracy, we must maintain the path. It's a difficult path to ride, but we must try to stick to it. There was a question about privatization. I would probably veer away from, because I think that's something that is almost in discussion. If you think about it, there is general, you have to open up the sector, obviously, but the telco sector is bigger than just network business. It is about infrastructure, it is about a whole range of other elements of it. So it's not just network, because if you think about it, telecom and all, it's a network business. But the danger is that it's also an infrastructure business, it's also all of those issues. So the conversation should be broader. Opening up the sector means also ensuring that you diversify in all of those areas. And I would not specifically talk about the thing. But consolidation of the sector is important. Because if we are to lower down the price of networks, etc., of communication in South Africa, we've got to ensure that there is consolidation in a bit of the sector. Because at the moment, I think if you take an opposite direction, you can go on in different countries. You'll see that the problems of consolidation are an issue. On privatization, by the way, I'm probably... it's something that I think, if you think about privatization, I've never been a proponent of privatization in any way, actually. Because the challenge is that how do you privatize in a context where the state is corrupt? Imagine if we went into privatization when the Guptas were in power. Sorry, should I say Zuma? So effectively... Effectively, the outcome would have been dangerous, basically. But also you have models if you take Singapore, with all its faults, the state-linked companies, which are essentially your state-owned companies, are probably the most competitive, the most effective, for a different reason, because there's a focus on the bottom line, there's a focus on building skills in these entities, etc., etc. So it's not a matter of saying the state must lose control or ownership. It's a matter of address the fundamentals, that if it is a company, at least it must have skills and capabilities, at least it must focus on bottom line, etc., etc. I guess the last question was about, I don't know, the wasted layers. It's a big debate. You know, the problem is that I think we've had a bad year, years, 10 years. I don't use the word wasted years because I think we learned something in that period. I think maybe it's wasted in the sense that we could have moved faster, but there's a lot of lessons that we learned in that period. My lamentation is that you don't see that those lessons reflected in the current government programs. You don't see those lessons reflected in the ANC's thinking about the future. So we have a lot of lessons in front of us, but we didn't learn anything. And that's my own lamentation, as it were. How do you save the economy? I guess it's a debate that we can have. But my view is that I think there is a tendency to almost think that growth is not important. My stance is that we've got to drive growth. We've got to look at those factors that are important for growth. One of them is investment, create the right climate for investment. At the same time, in driving growth, we've got to ensure that we transform the economy. And that's why my view is that building consciously an African or black entrepreneurial class should be our focus, and a productive class, not just consumptive class. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Rhetorically, I said, what if our institutions of democracy lose legitimacy? As Amilcar Cabral once said, people are not fighting for things in people's minds. They are fighting to improve their material condition. If we keep pontificating about institutions of democracy, but people on the ground realize that we are not moving with urgency. A person who is going to sleep on the sidewalk today, a person who is going to be raped today, and who knows that they are helpless every day, and we, the elite, are content, we are going to watch that on the news, they're in a different mindset altogether. And it is for that reason that in the Weimar Republic in Germany, when things were collapsing, they said, let's try Adolf Hitler. Because everything was failing. So the point I'm raising here is, if we, the elite, do not realize that and move with speed and have real trade-offs, people will be left with no alternative. Because they'll have to say, do I need freedom of movement and freedom of association, or do I need to just have a shelter and food? Because that's one of the travesties of our constitution in the human rights chapter. We emphasize the first generation rights of association, of movement, of expression. The second generation, which talks about material things, we tend to de-emphasize them. So it is not for the loving of the Chinese model, but for the inevitability of people beginning to look at other options if we don't move with speed. The last one on the practical question, solutions to development. I've been involved in rural community development for more than 3 decades, starting with my village. One of the things, we are in a fiscal crisis, so you can't say government add this or that. It's how you improve your efficiencies and be more innovative. Of course, Wom Jonas has already alluded to a number of those, but I want to just pick 2. You know that we're already spending close to 200 billion on social grants. But how do we make that money to circulate within the communities before it goes away? Buy uniform, buy food, everything, but what happens? People go to Boxer and ShopRite. A And nothing of that money is spent in the communities where people are. So how does social development begin to incentivize expenditure of that within the communities? Of course, you would have to eradicate corruption so that people can do business without hindrance, state pay on time. It was very often, now sitting at the Public Service Commission, some government departments, because of corruption, are the cause of the collapse of small businesses. Because bafuninjonjo, so they won't pay you for the work done. And creditors are on your back. So there are a number of other initiatives. Of course, there are gardens in the villages which are lying fallow, even where there is water. So some of the small things that we can do within communities, then there are certain things at a macro policy level that can be done. Thank you.
Thank you so much for the questions that you've asked and for responding to those questions. Honored guests, we're now going to move on to the vote of thanks. And I'm quickly going to introduce Mr. Mweletsi Mbeki is a political analyst, author, and an entrepreneur. He's a director of several companies, is chairman of KMM Investments, KMM Review Publishing, MGM Capital Investments, and executive chairman of Pomegranate Media. Mweletsi is the author of Architects of Poverty, Why African Capitalism Needs Changing. He edited Advocates for Change. I'm tempted to say order, honorable members. He edited Advocates for Change, How to Overcome Africa's Challenges. Both books have been translated into Chinese. He has recently co-authored a manifesto for social change, How to Save South Africa, with his niece, Dr. Nobantu Mbeki. He is national chairman of the South African Institute for International Affairs, an independent think tank based at the University of Witwatersrand, and is a former member of the Council of the International Institute for Strategic Studies, which is based in London. After returning to South Africa from exile in 1990, he was appointed head of communications for the Congress of South Africa Trade Unions and media consultant to the African National Congress. During most of the 1980s, he was a senior journalist for the Zimbabwe newspapers in Harare. As a result of the outstanding work that he did for the Zimbabwe newspapers features department, he was awarded a Nieman Fellowship by Harvard University for 1988 to 1989 academic years. Mbeki began his journalism career in London in 1979 as a contributor to Africa, New African, Africa Now magazines, and to the BBC Africa Service, as I conclude. He studied building management and sociology in England, obtaining an MA degree in sociology from the University of Warwick in 1982. He worked in the construction industry in the United Kingdom and in Tanzania during the 1970s. Honored guests, Mr. Mweletsi Mbeki.
Madam Moderator, Vice Chancellor, ladies and gentlemen, I've been told the students have to leave, so I will keep my vote of thanks very short. In my own family, my assignment is to give a vote of thanks at family funerals. So that just shows you that I'm a very well-practiced person in giving votes of thanks. But, as I say, but my vote of thanks are about funerals. So I was asking myself, now, who are we burying today? Because that's how I associate vote of thanks with. And I looked at the keynote speaker's analysis of the settlement that we entered into in the 1990s. If we had time, I would read it to you again, but I will just read one paragraph. It is useful to briefly go back to South Africa's democratic transition and relook at the considerations that gave rise to our political settlement. As with the former Eastern Bloc countries, we had a form of elite-led democratization in which the ruling elite acceded to concessions, in our case, political rights, with some redistribution benefits. These typically only happen when the cost of concession outweigh the cost of status quo and the risk of violent revolution. Such top-down and elite-driven political transitions rarely produce variants of democracy in which there are political rights, property rights, and civil rights. In fact, democratic transitions that guarantee all three baskets of rights, political, property, and civil rights, are the exception rather than the rule in societies with social cleavages and inequalities. Most developing societies are unable to walk down this narrow corridor. Liberal democratic variants of democracy usually occur where there is significant industrialization, as in Western Europe and the US, where there are relatively homogeneous populations and minimal social cleavages, such as Korea and Japan. I will stop there. What does this tell us about South Africa today? What it actually tells us is why it is that half of the South African population every night goes to bed hungry. That is what this tells us. So what are we going to be burying today? We are going to be burying, or we have buried today, or we are burying today, the agreement that makes half of the people of South Africa go to bed hungry. This is what Uom Gabisi has told us. And this is why I am so grateful for the work that he has done. I am so grateful for the analysis and the energy and the commitment he put into preparing for this speech. Lastly, Madam Chair, when I was driving to the airport this morning from home in Johannesburg to come here, there was a discussion about coalition parties, which again were mentioned today. And there was and I asked myself, why are coalition parties failing in South Africa? And I came to the conclusion that actually there's one reason why coalition parties are failing, and there's one reason why we had this settlement. All South African political parties today are parties of the middle class. There are no parties of the working class in South Africa. Interestingly, there are no parties of the rich in South Africa. People think that the DA is a party of the rich. The DA is a party of the white middle class. Why the colored workers support it, I still don't know. But it is a party of the white rich. We don't have a party of the working class in South Africa. We don't have a party of the rich in South Africa. And we don't have a party of the poor in South Africa. We have 600 parties registered with the IEC, all of which are parties of the rich, all of which are perpetuating the agreement that, that, that we entered into in the 1990s. So today, I'm glad to be serving in the same capacity that I normally serve in the family, which is to read, to thank you for coming to the funeral of those parties and to the funeral that is giving us half of our population in poverty. We have to redo South Africa. We have to reorganize our politics so that nobody in the rich country that South Africa is goes to bed hungry. I thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
I'm sure in your family they don't thank you after you've thanked everyone, so I would like to thank you.
Can I go now?
No, you can't go. If you can just stay, Wom Jonas and Prof Vikeni and VC, if you can please just come forward. Just as our token of appreciation to all of you, VC will hand over our gifts to you. Thank you, Missy. Thank you. Thank you so much. Honored guests, ladies and gentlemen, this brings to the end our inaugural Govan Mbeki Memorial Lecture at Nelson Mandela University. Thanks for your time. Go home safely.